When life gets kind of crazy, don't let it bring you down. Just do the hokey pokey, turn yourself around. Don't let a little sniffle get you running off to bed. It may feel like the end of the world, but you can laugh it off instead. 'Cause just around the corner, not far beyond the bend, it's a fairy tale that belongs to you and has a happy end. Just pass the next horizon, a kingdom waits for you. It's deep within your soul. It's all your dreams come true. With these happy thoughts, let us all plunge into the journey within, a journey along with Soul Charger by Archana Duranda. Good evening, my name is Parjana Kirtikar and I welcome you all to the book launching ceremony of my aunt's first book, The Soul Charger. I wish you all the best and I'm confident that you all will love a book and benefit from it. Thank you.
So Archana, he's already stolen your limelight. I mean, starting with it. I need to get back the limelight on Archana. I've known Archana since the past 22 years. We worked together in the jewelry industry. We were in seats. We used to work together. But in all those years, I never knew that, she even thought about writing. Kabhi bola nahi tha kisko usne. Inner kisko bola nahi tha. Because what happens is when you say that, listen, if you're a non-writer, I want to write a book, people normally ridicule you or make fun of you. So this is a desire which she kept burning and she pursued it. And, especially a book on spirituality is something so niche. I mean, she must really be wanting to do this really badly, or it must be thanks to the mentors that she came across. So whether it was her boss, Aristata, who supported her at the right time, or whether it was when you went to Ekankur Holistic Center, Anjaliji over there, or her, when she went to Brahma Kumaris. In fact, the first manuscript of this book had been blessed by Sister Shifani, if I'm not mistaken. Okay? So that was the first kind of official of kind of a thing where it was blessed. Going further, I mean, everything that I talk to you, it's better if somebody who's really close to her. Because though I've known her for 22 years, I think one-to-one I must have met her 5 times. Not more than that. Oh, 5 is a 3 time to abhi iske karan mile hum. So let me ask Sonali. Sonali is a close friend. Sonali, why don't you come over and, share what Archana is all about.
Hi, friends. I'm actually overwhelmed with she being a friend since about 12, 13, 14 years. It feels forever. I was introduced to her by my friend, who we stay together in the US, Sheetal, and we connected immediately. It was a spirit in her that connected with me, and we became really close. I'm very, very happy and honored to have read her first draft. Nobody has seen it. I was the first person to read the draft, what she has written. And I felt that she has put in her heart, soul, everything in it. And it was very beautifully written. I think everybody should read her book because it is written so simply. She has come up with herself. She is a very naive, very simple soul. I've never seen a person like her. She has put so much effort in making people happy. Though she becomes hurt, she doesn't like it, but she will always smile. And that's what her spirit is about. That's what my friend is today. And I wish her all the best. And happy birthday to you. Love you, Archana. And all the best to you in your life. And hope you come up with the second book, like I told you, next year. The edition of this. Thank you very much. And hope you all read her book if you have not. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, Sonali. Like you said, all read the book. I haven't read a lot of books in the recent, past 6 months. And I just happened to ponder through the first 16 or 17 pages. And then I read things like, there were people talking about it as being a missing manual for spirituality or something like that. So I said, that's a very far-fetched missing manual on spirituality for someone who I knew so close. and then somebody else talks about it as it's a book on chase and opportunities. Very, very commercial, very business-like. So I was wondering, okay, how can something appeal so differently to people who read this? And then I realized that I have to ponder deeper into it. And I went deeper into it, and then I suddenly, it struck me somewhere that, do you know where the soul is? Where do you think the soul is? How many people know where the soul is? If I say, identify the soul in your body. Soul hai kaan pe? Yeah? Heart. Thank you.
I guess the soul is obviously in our...
Put across, the soul lies here. So it's supposed to be between your eyebrows. And the soul, the position, the physical position of the soul is here. So I said, wow, I need to know something. I always thought heart is here, so soul idhar hota hoega. But no, it's here. And the function that the soul plays, okay, in life is that it tries to record everything that you go through. And depending on how spiritually inclined you are or how you take in it, those things which you go through, they remain with you. So there's a few interesting things. And there was something which S-O-U-L stood for. What did S-O-U-L stand for? Source of? Yeah, so like the book says, S-O-U-L stands for the source of unique light. So it's like a unique light which is within you, which you go out, which you energize, which you charge, and that's what this whole book is about. As part of the day, I won't take too much of time, we're going to have a book reading. Along with the book reading, after that we're also going to be having a panel discussion, which is why all these special people have been called who are here to energize us more. So let's start with the book reading. Okay, we're going to read the book. Aristata is, what do I call you now? I mean, he's been my boss also at one point in time. When I started my career in 92, he was my boss. He's one of the most seasoned jewelry professionals we have. He's a mentor to Archana. He's a friend to Archana. He's a guide to Archana. So he's going to be doing the first part of the book reading. So why don't you join us here? He'll also be followed later by Shweta. Why don't you come up here, meanwhile? So Shweta is a multi-faceted young lady. She's an artist. She acts. She also dabbles with her mother in a radio channel. This is all that I've figured out. I mean, nothing else about you, I know. And Archana, you'll also be required up here because then you're going to, you know, do the concluding paragraph. Okay? Sorry.
Right. So good evening, everybody. Like Naveen rightfully said, getting a full house here with friends of Archana all here to support her. But everyone who knows Archana would be there if Archana went on any kind of adventure. We'd be always be there to support her. Everyone who knows Archana will agree with me that whenever she starts anything, she just, you know, gets fully involved with it, you know, with full involvement and sincerity. And that clearly comes across in this book. I'm not much of a reader, I don't read a lot, but I did read this book because it's so simply and honestly put. And also my 80-year-old mother went through this book. I don't think she's gone through any book in her life. Actually, I didn't know whether you knew that. But my mom read the entire book, and that again is one of the testimonies that it's so simple and so truthful that you can't put it down easily. And so I chose a paragraph, one passage from the book which talks about meditation. And I chose it for two reasons, because one is both Megha and myself started our spiritual journey almost 5 years ago with Vidisha Foundation, with Sadhguru. And one of the big challenges that I faced personally was to sit down in one place and meditate. I'm sure anybody who's dabbled with it a little bit will understand what that is. No matter how much anyone tells you about it's easy, you sit down, you shut your eyes, you focus on your breathing, it doesn't happen because you're so used to being all over the place. So that took a while to settle in. But once it did, everything else has been magical after that. So I picked this passage, and I'm just going to read it. It's not very long. And so bear with me, because I already mentioned that I'm not much of a reader. So, and this is page 10 from her book, and she writes, and I read. With the busy lives we lead, full of commitments and responsibilities, slaves of time, there comes the need to give your thought and mind the much-needed break to pause, to relax, to breathe in calmness, and to breathe out stress. We need to silence the traffic of our thoughts and balance the outburst of our emotions. This is possible by bringing some discipline to our regular routine and making time to be with ourselves. Quieten your mind, drive away the many thoughts that race through it, and focus your concentration to think nothing. Listen to the voice of stilled silence, which is the voice of God, and feel His presence. This process is called meditation. There are various methods of meditation taught and shared by experts and spiritual gurus in seminars, workshops, social medias, audio, video, etc. It is the need of the hour to learn these techniques that best suit our convenience and make them a part of our daily routine. Frequency and duration are subjective to a person's priority and time available. The suggested minimum is 5 to 10 minutes per day, gradually increasing from there. As per the Brahma Kumari's Raj Yoga meditation, the best time to meditate is in the wee hours of the morning between 2 a.m. and 5 a.m., called the Brahma Muhurta, when God showers His choicest blessings on His children who reach out to Him through meditation. It's important to note that making time for meditation does not take away time from your busy schedule. In fact, it adds more time to your day. Your meditation, your creativity, energy levels, productivity, and pace of work increase, charges your soul, and keeps your health in check. With regular practice, it will bring about a significant change in your personality, health, and outlook towards life. You'll feel feather light, experience sudden bouts of happiness, and a magical presence of God, which cannot be explained at the end of this para. It says, meditate and take charge of your life. Like I said, it's so simply put, and highly recommend the book as well as meditation. And thank you, Archana, for giving me this opportunity to read out this passage. And also use this opportunity of rock, like a rock. So thank you so much for that. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Because I may not reach this mic. But okay, luckily I have.
It's always freshly charged.
So I have met Archana for the first time, thanks to Naveen. He was the one who played the instrument. So firstly, happy birthday. And I must say, the moment I spoke to her on the phone, there was some instant connect. It was like universe was just trying me out to meet her, and we couldn't meet, but the phone itself felt like we've known each other for a while. And when she said you'll read a passage, I said obviously I would love to read something that you've written. And when the book came to me, this was the passage that called out to me, which says, be open to receive. And this is something my mom keeps telling me, and I've been following it and consciously trying to be open to receive, because my mom always says a buffet is laid, but you should be open to eat it. So this is the passage that Archana would love to read. Be open to receive. The universe has an abundance of everything you ask for. Its doors are always open for you, anytime and every time. It is for you to reach out to the universe through thought power and ask for what you want with clear intent. Before you ask, you need to declare yourself to be open to receive what the universe will bestow upon you. This is the basic principle of spiritual healing. Being open means clearing your emotional and mental blockages, keeping faith in the universal life force energy, and welcoming it with open arms. When you surrender to the universe without afterthought, the universe takes charge of you and sets you free. Release all your stress, fears, and anxieties. Empty your mind and keep it open to receive love, peace, and light.
Thanks a lot. Before you get into the reading, I mean, can you narrate something about this journey? Because you've not got a chance to talk. You know, I've got a chance to talk. Everybody's going to talk. Before you get onto this, anything that you would want to share about this process or about it?
Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for being present here to share this special moment of the release of my book, The Soul Charger. The journey of the Soul Charger has been really interesting. I had a lot of ups and downs all through until this morning as well. But there's something that I learned through the entire journey, which I would just like to say in one sentence, not taking too much time, that the Soul Charger taught me to keep this thought constant in my mind, try me instead of why me. Because I used to be a person who used to cry at the drop of a hat that, you know, something goes wrong, someone says something, Archana is crying. So there you go. All those who are close to me know that too well. So I've been like, okay. I would say that each and every topic that I have chosen in my book, I have lived through it in the past 2 years. The last being The Magic of Universe, when I actually wanted to have a book launch and it was just not getting possible for whatever reason. Something or the other was going wrong. The last being we had a serious car accident. But it's like I sent out a clear intent to the universe that this is what I wanted, and God kind of sent his little messengers around in the form of Sanchita, in the form of Megha, in the form of Aries, my other friends, my cousins, my family, and they just made it possible for me. So if it was not for all of you, I would not be able to launch my book today. So I would say that the Soul Charger taught me a clear thought, which I think everyone should follow, is say to yourself, try me instead of why me. Thank you. When I started to write the Soul Charger, I did take a lot of tips from different people on how they would like a spiritual book to be. Because being an avid reader myself, I know how books, like spiritual books, can be really interesting and they can be really boring. So there were friends of mine like Sheetal who said, this is the time of instant age when everyone wants to send a WhatsApp to their friends and they want good quotations and good values. So, you know, the book should be really fast, that when you write something in there and if you really find a good quotation, then the quotation itself speaks for itself. You don't even have to go through the matter there. So I try to write my book in small paras. So it's like you don't really need to continuously read the book. You can just pick up any page whenever you feel down or whenever you feel you want to read something to boost yourself up, or you know, to get yourself in better spirits. And I use the form of quotations. So my book has this unique concept which my little Levy will talk to you all about later, when you can really open to any page and you can tell the Almighty that this is the question I have in mind, can you give me an answer? And the page that you open up to gives you an answer. So when I decided to think of what should I speak during the book reading, I opened up to page 51, which says, attitude of gratitude builds relationships. Well, this is the very topic which I have chosen to write on in my next book about relationships. And this is again a sign from the universe that that's what I'm supposed to do. So today it's just a short one that I'll talk about, and then you'll read it in my next book. So it goes, a simple thank you can move a person and transform negative feelings to positive. Expressing gratitude is an exchange of positive emotions. It makes one feel acknowledged, appreciated, and noticed for a thought, gesture, act, or deed. It establishes a connection and builds and heals relationships. Well, I truly believe in this. That's the reason I have written, is that relationships are very important to me in my life. I try my best to bear it up whenever I get upset. There are moments when I am really not happy with the way things go around, the situations are, people treat me. It just goes on. I think every one of us faces that. But then I keep telling myself, look for the good in that person. I want to maintain a relationship, I have to look at it from another perspective. And that's how I keep holding on to my relationships and, you know, making more friends and reaching out to more people. And I wish my Soul Charger really touches as many souls possible. And it reaches out to everyone. And it gives me an encouragement to write more such books which are soul touching and which I believe, and along with me, all of you believe. Thank you.
Thank you, Archana, Shweta, Aris, for giving us your perspective and a jhalak of the book. You three guys are lucky you've got your copies already, you know. The others, there are enough copies that Archana has ensured are available here in Tidal Waves. Please get your copy. Archana, you promised that if there are 200 of them, you're going to sign all 200 copies. Yeah, you're going to be sitting here somewhere in the end and you're going to sign all of them. Okay, so for everybody who buys a copy from here, Archana is going to be here signing all the copies. Okay, let's get on to the next part of the program, which is the panel discussion. Okay, we've got seven interesting sets of people, all coming from different parts of society, having different expertise. Most of them are women. Archana, you're a woman, so you make sure there are more women on the panel. Okay? So I'll call the men first. Okay? Is it okay to call the men first? Okay. I think I'm the senior most person over here. Chandrakant Bhai Yapo. Yeah? So Chandrakant Gokani, why don't you come up? Chandrakant Gokani is a spiritual counselor. Pick up the left. Okay. So let's hear it for them as they come up. Vikram Bhai, come. So, director, producer, and Abhat Nachali. Miss Aruna Raje, filmmaker, educationalist, and a motivational speaker. This is Suchanda Chatterjee, architect, writer, and a social worker. All these people are very close to Archana, that's why they're here. Okay. Megha and Archana, you're going to come last. Okay. Anjali Sen Gupta, Reiki teacher, and an alternative healing therapist. Mrs. Roop Lakhani, a practicing tarot card reader, a healer, a coach. Anybody else? Okay, so Archana, why don't you come up here and take a seat? Lady who's made it possible for Archana to have this big launch. Archana was, one of the things that always concerned her was, I've done the book writing process and it's all published, but how do people come to know about it? So she wanted a support system and, just at the brink of time, like she says, ki last moment tak mereko pata nahi tha kya hoga. And then an angel walks in out of the blue and in charge of the entire panel. And she is soon going to be, okay, she's going to be the MD at Discovery. Okay.
Okay, I think I need a, maybe I'll just stand, that's a good idea. Yeah. Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much for coming and supporting Archana in this wonderful journey, which she has just, given you a glimpse of how to charge your soul. But I'm really excited about today's panel interaction. We have a very interesting mix of people who are big achievers in their own respective field. And audience, I think, is this mic? Is that how it works? Okay. Yes. Director knows it all. So, soul charger, and before I start this interaction, I think one of the things I definitely want to start by is that I myself am not much of a reader, but I did read this book, and I think what really appealed to me is its simplicity. And I think we have a few people in our panel as well, with Arunaji and Vikram. I think when you want to connect with people, simplicity of storytelling is extremely important, isn't it? How you relate to the individuals you might have, and we've seen that in films in lately as well, that you might have a very big star cast, but if the story doesn't connect to the audience, it really doesn't work. And you might not have a very big star cast film, but if the story connects with the audiences, and that's when it becomes a blockbuster. So to me, the soul charger is that small, simple, simplistic storytelling proposition, which I hope a blockbuster for Archana. So with that said, I'd like to begin with Chandrakantji. I have to face. Yeah. So I'd like to begin with Chandrakantji. I think Chandrakantji, for those who don't know, is a spiritual counselor, and he represents the Brahma Kumaris. He's had a very special role to play in Archana's life and journey as well. So, Chandrakantji, basically, I wanted to understand, you know, we all know about, we've all been experiencing spirituality in different levels, in different ways. Like I think it was mentioned that we all, whether different gurus or different ways of reaching that inner soul. Would you like to touch upon as to what is the Raj Yoga part of when we say, you know, soul, which has been described by Archana through the Raj Yoga of, from Brahma Kumari's point of view. What is, if you can share with us in the audience, your perspective of spirituality through through Raj Yoga?
Brothers and sisters, good evening to all of you. It's a pleasure meeting you all over here at the launch ceremony of Archana's book on the soul charger. Now, as she said, Mega Madam said, Raj Yoga meditation, what is the secret of it? Now, Raj Yoga meditation is to know thyself thoroughly and rightly. We all introduce ourselves as our names. Say, my name, Chandrakant, or Ramesh, Mega, Naveen. But is this our right introduction? Can anyone say on it something? Is it right introduction? When you were born, what was your name?
Nothing.
Then what was your identity?
Nothing.
Are you the same?
No.
You are not same?
Maybe not, I don't know. It's like asking you, sir.
We are same, you know. Actually, any human being you look around, it is, there are two components of it. One is our soul, and the second one is our body. Soul is immortal. We have read it a lot, but probably we have not experienced it. And Raj Yoga meditation is that process which repositions you in this world. So long as we were acting by our name, but then in reality, absolute truth is we are all souls. Now, how to know that soul? Because soul is not visible as such, but you can experience. Suppose someone was to ask you, do you see wind around or air blast around? Can you see?
No.
No, we cannot see, but can we feel it?
Yes.
Yeah, suppose all doors were locked, AC was shut, after 10 minutes everyone would perspire and say, oh, there is no air conditioning or there is no flow of air. Exactly same way, I am speaking to you, you are listening me. Assume it, I pop out for a moment. What I was visible a second ago is same thing before you. But will I be able to interact with you?
No.
Why? My soul is out. That's why I am popped out.
Right.
So what remains is my this inert body. Soul is a live entity. Soul can think. And what soul thinks, that only our body follows it. Body cannot think. A person, suppose he is given a sweetmeat shop, a piece, he would cherish it. Oh, it's lovely. But suppose a corpus is lying, and you gave him not one, multiple sweets, will that corpus cherish? So who is cherishing? Who is thinking? Who is acting? Is our soul only. And soul is the probably, you can say, 51% holder of this company and 49% is my body. Majority controls are with the soul. But when your sanskaras, they drive your soul, na? Then even if something you don't want to do, but by habit, we start doing it. And that is known as our sanskaras are overdriving our soul. But ideally, it is our soul which has to drive our actions in this world.
Yeah. Now that's very very profound way of highlighting the fact that, you know, where
fundamentals
of soul. You know, I'll come back to you on that, Chandrakantji, and I'd like to take forward this discussion now with Suchanda. Suchanda is an interior designer. She's now a scriptwriter, storyteller, has been inclined towards spirituality for many, many years, I'm given to understand. Suchanda, if you can, you know, we were chatting earlier and we were discussing, and she was very intrigued by the concept of angels being the messengers of God. And, you know, how there are a whole lot of angels which exist amongst us. It's up to us, you know, whether you find that angel is for you or not. So can you shed some light on what's your view on angels being there, and if they are really the messengers of God?
Thank you, Megha. You know, from my childhood, I've been only reading Beauty and the Beast and Cinderella. And after that, after so many years, I have read Soul Charges. So I've been looking for a page where it is written, where she has mentioned the angels. Mm-hmm. So I've got a page there, you know. She has written messengers of God called angels. It's page number 14, I'm sure, right? So now, I was thinking of my Beauty and the Beast and Cinderella, which the only books I have written, I mean, I have read so far. So I was thinking, what is the common between those two books, those two stories, and this chapter that's called Angel? Now, we don't see angels in our lives. Of course, we don't, because the life is so hard. As, you know, Archana said that whenever she used to feel sad, she used to cry. And I was wondering that she didn't find the angel till the time she actually got her angel to write the book, Soul Charger. So I think the angels are actually soul chargers. They come to your life all of a sudden, and it's your, maybe you can say, good fortune, or you're the chosen one. Maybe God has tried you. That's why she said, try me, why not why me. And you just have to recognize them and hold their hands, you know, and walk through. As, you know, I have just heard from somebody, you know, very known to me, very dear to me, maybe she's my angel, and she said, there are only 30% of your soul, you know, there is there in your body, and the rest of the 70% is in ether. And that's why sometimes we meet some people around us and we call them soulmates. Maybe they are, you know, remaining part of her soul. So coming back to her book, what she has written, what she has tried to write, it's so simply she has written something which is very big. But we have to understand the depth of it. As I understood my angel's story through my Beauty and the Beast and Cinderella. And I hope Archana gets the same angel as both the stories, you know, the heroines or whatever, the protagonist got their angels. All the best to you, Archana. Yeah.
Do you know how would you recognize your angel? How would you know who's your angel?
See, sometimes we think that somebody who's energizing us, not through monetary or, you know, any materialistic things. Energizing us means, you know, they make you laugh, they make you happy. Like how they go to Brahma Kumari, they become, you know, they get a lot of peace from there. No matter, maybe some people don't understand the thought, what Brahma Kumari is saying, or anybody in Sadhguru, you know, saying. Maybe some people, very common people, they're very, you know, maybe they're not as fortunate as us. They don't understand, but they get a lot of peace and a lot of happiness from that environment, from the talk. They look at the guru and then they get that, you know, happiness. But what you said, what you asked me about how do you recognize them? You have to be the chosen one, because God sends angels to few people. And you have to be the fortunate one. Or you have to wait for, you know, few years or maybe few births to recognize them. Sorry to disappoint you.
So
but still, this is the fact.
There are angels out there, but there's not one for everyone, is what I'm hearing. But moving to, thank you so much, Suchanda. I'd like to move to Arunaji, you know, and she comes with such repute of filmmaking, story writing, fabulous movies she has done, national award winner, and she represents an industry body like films in Bollywood, which many people tell me, again, this is hearsay, that to be in the film, sometimes you have to sell your soul. Now, if you're selling your soul, how do you charge it?
At some point, you have to confront that. People do all kinds of things. And mostly, you know, what happens is that people who are there for creativity, to express themselves, to communicate something that's burning, like you want to tell a story or you want to share a thought. So there are people, filmmakers, who want to do that, who want to communicate something. And there are other people who are there for the money, for the business of it and the glamour of it. Mm. So, I mean, everybody has to make a choice at some point how far you want to go and what do you really want in your life. Mm. And there are people who do what you call sell their souls, but at some point they have to confront it. It's not like you've gotten away with it. Mm. So mm. that's what it is.
True. And have you, in your experience, you know, I'm sure you have had many choices to make, right? And I'm sure as a woman filmmaker in this so-called, with all due respect, Vikram, male-dominated industry.
yes, absolutely.
Yeah. How have you been able to make those choices without selling your soul?
Yeah, it has been very difficult, actually, because as the first girl technician to, first of all, come out of the Film Institute and get into the industry. I mean, there were no girls before that. And when I was working, people would tell me, ladki hai, ladki hai. They'd come into the studio and see, like, in the editing, in the lab, they just come to ladki hai. I mean, this was in the 69, I passed out. I'm an ancient, I'm actually.
You don't look bad at all, ma'am.
Because
you have a young soul.
Yes, actually, you're right. Everybody said, are you 72 or 27?
I'll go with 27.
Yes, because I also am a life coach. And this is something that called me. You know, you go through ups and downs in your life. One is your profession, something you love to do, make movies. And you're all the time confronted with situations which are unworkable. Now you have to decide which way you want to go. You want to make another film, and you know, selling your soul may also mean selling your body.
Mm.
Let's not be honest about
mm-hmm.
it. Or being completely corrupt or have no integrity or something. Like, you have a choice.
Mm.
And you choose your work, you choose your films, you choose the people you want to be with. And that's a journey. And in spite of, even if you do everything so-called right, then life also throws things at you. You know, like in cricket, we say, you know, you don't know what ball you're getting, and are you going to stand there and hit it, or are you going to run back into the pavilion saying, I can't handle it?
Right.
So you have to deal with it. And once you deal with it, you kind of begin to evolve, which for me, you know, I actually, you know, it's a lot of introspection. For me, spirituality is like, you know, connecting to the universe. So for me, like, my life is about being one with the universe. So I don't resist anything. And if you're talking of angels, I mean, angels come in different forms as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, may not recognize them, but also something she said earlier, which is reading, you have to be able to receive.
Mm.
Are you ready to receive the grace? Are you ready to receive the blessings?
Mm.
And as you clean up, and I'm saying clean up the clutter, clean up the negativity and all that,
mm-hmm.
and then life is wonderful. I mean, it's a joy ride because you're connected to the universe. You have no issues. Universe is taking care of you. Universe gives you what you want, really. I mean, you know, put your intention to the universe. Universe says that has to.
Wow.
And that's my experience.
Wonderful. Beautifully said, ma'am.